Welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up, we look at... Hey! Thanks for coming. Now, coming up, we look at the latest tools and updates to get DevOps right the first time by instrumenting ops considerations directly into your dev practices and tools using Azure Governance. We'll show you the latest in Azure Policy to help you audit, enforce, and take action to remediate out-of-policy resources, how you can ensure scale and set up new governed environments in a repeatable way using the new Azure Blueprints service, and validate your infrastructure configuration in your CICD workflows for vulnerabilities and compliance violations before deployment with native integration using Azure DevOps, formerly known as VSTS. So I'm pleased to be joined by Jeremy Winter. Good to have you, sir.
Yeah,
no stranger to Microsoft Mechanics.
Yeah, no, it's great to be back. Love it.
Now, excellent. So a well-known pain point with DevOps is that while developers get agility with the cloud, it's often been hard for IT to maintain control over infrastructure costs, data compliance, and things like operational requirements.
Yep, and that's right. And so when you think about it, in the on-prem world, with the IT, you actually controlled how the resources were determined. From, heck, you ordered the hardware that came into the environment, and you also chose how you allocated those resources. But frankly, when you think about it, the cloud gives our developers that limitless access, and we want that. That's all goodness. We want them to have that native and limitless access. It's all awesome when you think about the speed, but you also need to put some guardrails in place here. It helps keep both IT and the development and yourself out of trouble from provisioning, say, too expensive solutions out there, too expensive resources, or even getting configurations potentially wrong that then would jeopardize even some of that sensitive data you have.
Right, so what are we doing to help solve for that?
Yeah. So, you know, first, last year at Ignite, we really just announced Azure Policy.
Mm-hmm.
And when we think about Azure Policy, it's something we've been investing heavily in for the course of the last year. And it really just provides you this control mechanism in Azure that really helps you start to, you know, think about the policies and controls you want to put in place. But when I talk about that being native, you also just want it to be able to be right through the portal itself. And so as your developers go use that portal, it has those native controls as baked in. So what I need to show you.
Sounds good, let's take a look.
Cool. So on the screens here, we've got the Azure portal, and I want to just go create something simple. From the dev side, I want to go create a new VM. So I'm just going to choose create a resource here. And choose Windows Server 2016.
It's a great start.
Yeah, that's a great start.
Yep.
Great start. And so as I come into that, create the virtual machine, inside this virtual machine, now I can go fill these core components out as a developer or someone else inside the organization. And I'm going to go change the size. So here's the notion. I'm going to go pick this size. Let's go pick an expensive one.
So you're saying that DS1 just isn't enough for
your
workload?
That's not enough for
right?
me. I'm going to go see if I can get a D16 out here.
I see what's happening
there
here.
There we
right,
go.
Okay.
Big time.
Right.
So let's select this one.
This is a scenario that has never happened before.
No.
I can tell by some of the
Actually, I think you pay for it, not me.
Excellent.
So let's just
Thank you.
It just goes somewhere else. Someone else has the budget. When I'm done with this, I come through and just create. Now, I should be off and running. I'm happy. I was just building a small marketing, just trying something out in my dev environment. But wait. Now I have a notice. I've got a validation failed. So what's going on here? Behind the scenes, we have a policy. And if I click the details of what that validation was, this was intentional. We want them to come. We want the folks that are being able to use it to see that, A, that policy that I tried to create, or that VM that I just tried to create in a different region, I was only allowed to do it, in the European regions. I sent the request that said I wanted to go build that app mm-hmm. into the European side. The second one is I'm only allowed A and B SKUs for my development environments. So our point on that is really just to make sure whether you're doing it through ARM, Azure Resource Manager, an API, or the portal, those policies are influenced right out of the gate. You don't need any other layers. It's just natively in there.
Yep, and you've saved me some money by not charging my card.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
And all this is great for system-level controls, but what about process-level controls? Can we expand there?
Yeah. So oftentimes, it's more than just the hardware, right? How many of you are using tags? Okay, you should be using more tags. These things are really useful when you think about just classifying how something is in your environment. Your metadata can be used, how it associates with an app. And in this scenario, we can see we have tags in the create new. Mm-hmm. And this just enforces me the same reason. I can come in and say, look, I have a cost center. My cost center is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And that is also a policy that you can put in place to enforce. Now, this is a free form tag. But I could also enforce that it had the right drop-downs inside it, so I could only choose cost centers exist. This is good so you can ensure and track those resources inside the environment. We're seeing tags be used more and more, and as we bring policy into the picture, we're really seeing that start to be pervasive.
And you could apply tags previously afterwards, but this is now ahead of time.
Yeah, this is ahead of time before it even hits inside the environment.
Right, so what does the ops team need to do to get started setting some of these guardrails for their developers that they can use in their environment?
Yeah, absolutely. So when you think about from the ops perspective, what do I have out in that environment? We've talked about the create new, but how do I start to get a picture of those existing behaviors out inside the rest of the environment? And so this is where Azure Policy fits in. You can come in and start to see within Azure Policy, I'm able to create initiatives and policies that I can then go look across the environment on.
Right.
And that key piece is really just I can define the policies, but hold off before I start to execute them. So I look at here, example, here's that tags policy we just saw in my create new that I can enforce on the tags.
Yep.
But also if I want to say later come in from a security perspective and look at the express, I want to start to set up my express route subscriptions as an example. I can look and start to look across my entire environment and see which ones aren't compliant or not.
Right.
And the key thing I'll pinpoint about this one is if you look down the effective type, it's an audit. It's not going to do anything. It's just going to audit the environment to help me get a better pulse of what's going out there.
Right. So what about resources I've already got in my environment? Can we retroactively enforce policy?
Yeah, that's a great. I like that.
Right.
So this is a new feature we just rolled out this week. And let me go back into the policies. And show, let's say we want to go, as I have all this environment out there, we like to call it the brownfield or the existing environment that's out there. Here's an example I've been using with this log collections. And so I can go out and create an initiative that I want to go collect logs. I want to make sure I've got my diagnostic logs, whether it's against my SQL or network security groups or my VMs. But the key piece to this is we added this new element for those that have been watching with our overall policy. We've had audit, which is allowing me to see what's going on in the environment. We had deny, which is what you saw me put in place for the portal. Mm-hmm. And now we have deploy if not exists. Now, basically what that is, it allows me to remediate. So let's say I go choose these VM logs, and I already have thousands of VMs inside the environment. I can just create a remediation task. This remediation task allows you to roll out policies at your own discretion and your own pace. We did not give you the trigger to just go blast it across to everything. You can do that. But we wanted to let you choose, and based off of the feedback as we're working with some of the customers that we designed this with, I could choose my scope, which is to the subscription or resource group. I can also come down and choose the location. And for some of those that were in my session earlier, I talked about just I've already deployed, remember this morning or this afternoon, I deployed against Canada. And that is already fixed because we fixed it there and already rolled it out. So it still holds true, it's keeping that up. So now I feel good about the Canada environment. Now I'm going to roll through Central US.
Nice.
So that allows us to roll these things out over a period of time.
Cool. So the policy provides IT with the controls around the resources that are created, but how do we help IT to start to proactively define and create compliant environment from the start, especially considering things like scale and consistency?
Yeah. So this is one of those big asks that came out, is setting up well-governed or enterprise environments is just something we know takes time. It's a challenge today because you're rolling out subscriptions, but what about all my policies that I may want to apply that I ensure are upstream to those development environments? Or even if I'm migrating, how do I bring those in? And so this is a new announcement that we've really brought out and you're seeing us push is Blueprints, Azure Blueprints. And what Azure Blueprints is it's basically a repeatable way, an easy way to go define what's in an environment. Or I'm able to take my Azure resource templates, I'm able to then put access controls and policy and bring those all together in what's called a blueprint. Again, this blueprint is a really easy way for you to layer over the top of everything, whether you're doing it for your new environments, your existing, or even as you start to migrate into Azure. And so this blueprint, we think, is a really nice way that allows you to deploy a repeatable set of configurations into the environment.
And it sits on top of your ARM template.
Absolutely.
Your existing investments you've made creating
right
artifacts.
It sits right on the top of Azure Resource Manager and is native. So anything that goes on through that environment or anything that goes in the subscriptions, it's there. No third-party solutions over the top. It's native right inside Azure. And what's really cool is it's free. All these things I just showed you, policy and blueprinting, available at no additional cost. This is just what we want to do to make sure that you're secured and have those controls in place for the guardrails, especially as you move to this dev and IT and bringing those two worlds together.
So you've built it up. Now we have to see it. Can you show us?
Oh, yeah, I could do that. So let's switch over to blueprints. And so inside policy, or just do a search inside the portal for Azure Blueprints, we have a simple overview page, the format we've been doing with all our services these days. Mm-hmm. And I can basically come in and create these. Just for speed's sake, I'm going to go apply. I'm going to go look at how this sits. And so here are definitions that I've already created. Example is the Contoso Global Blueprint. Now remember, I told you it's basically a stack of these components that you can add. And so here's an assigned subscription. How, and this is exactly the scenario we just did. This is the blueprint that's applied to my environment. Allowed locations. Which locations can I do it? I want tags and how I can set up the policies for tags. It allows me to lay down the resources and the access groups that I want tied into this, which is tied to your management groups.
Yep.
Hits your Contoso infrastructure, my central log analytics workspace, so all that information's coming into logs. Everything for my network, clear down to that app team that's going to go deploy out into Europe. I know that they always need Cosmos DB and web app. If I've spent time with the as an architect working with the PM or with the development team, so we can even have tailored for each development team to lay down these subscriptions over the top.
So it's bringing together people, it's bringing together groups and applications and services and all of those keys.
Yeah. So it's simple, just to assign it. Remember, originally I'm like, gosh, I really just want another subscription. So I'm done with my development environment, but I need a pre-prod development environment over in Europe. And so I could come in here and choose this blueprint and which environment to apply it to. So I've already applied it to the dev test, so I'm going to go ahead and hit it into my pre-prod. So I, whether I'm a developer using this natively myself, the business team, where you can put self-delegation to this, just use our blueprints as you create it up, is easy to be able to apply. And then there's this notion I'll call lock. And when I choose lock, it allows me to lock this thing down so only the people that created it and have access to it can make the edits and changes the subscription. Or you could choose to just be a best practice approach and allow it to not lock.
And you've also got the definition version there. So as you evolve and you create new instances and new versions of this, you can still roll back, go forward.
And so it's a simple assign. Bam, it's already applied to the environment.
Cool. Excellent. So we've covered a decent amount of detail there about blueprints. How are we enforcing the guardrails without impacting things like developer productivity and the speed at which we want devs to operate?
Yeah, so this is key. So for the DevOps side, with DevOps in mind, what we really wanted to do is go include policy and blueprinting and just shift that upstream into the development pipelines. And so that's part of the reason we natively baked this into Azure and through. And so within Azure DevOps itself, which was formerly VSTS, we went and did the work to go plumb policy right inside Azure, Azure DevOps. So now, as I'm a developer and you're working with your development teams, I can rest assured that I'm running in the guardrails that IT set up, or I can go author and create my own blueprints inside so that my team sits within those policies.
Right.
And so here inside VSTS, I have that up and Azure DevOps. I have releases. And inside those releases, I have a pipeline of releases that are coming down the path. And what you want to do on that is be able to set up so your developers can automatically go deploy into Azure directly, and we have those connections in. And so here's release 4. But release 4 shows that it has a failure on that deployment. And if I drill in, natively in, it'll show you, okay, first I made some changes as a developer. I'm right in here. The automatic trigger kicked it out to go get that out into Azure.
Yep.
But then I had a failure that happened because of the policy. So I can see which policy, link over to policy, and we even give you down into the level of code so you can take as a developer right into the code and go look at the changes that you made.
Right.
And so here, for example, as I was moving from that dev environment to a pre-production environment, remote debugging I had set to true, and the policy I had set was false because I want to make sure when you come out into my pre-production or production environments, that setting is not there for a safety reason.
Yep.
And so the point I'm trying to show you at this level is you're able to get right down to the specific settings that you're going to bring. And in the course of the next few months, we're going to get you able to do it into the guest as well. So you can start to have your own custom configurations right down into the guests, not only just the Azure resource.
Awesome.
So that's how it fits when you think about it between the developers and IT.
Awesome. Fantastic update. Thanks for joining us today.
Love it.
Yeah. Here we go. Thank you. Good stuff. Now, where do people go to learn more?
Look, I think the fastest thing I'd say to go learn more is just go try it. It's already in the portal. It's out there. Just go in. Policies and blueprints are free. They're included. Just go into the portal, sign up, and start using the pieces.
Nice short URL to remember there as well. And of course, stay tuned to Microsoft Mechanics for the latest in tech updates. Subscribe on Twitter, and thanks for watching. Bye for now.
Okay, thanks, everybody.